Hi everybody, this is Dr. A. So in preparation for the phlebotomy venipuncture videos, we're going to go over the circulatory system in this video and then the lymphatic system in the next video before moving on to phlebotomy equipment and then venipuncture. So a quick review of the circulatory system. The pulmonary circulation carries blood between the heart and the lungs for gas exchange, and the systemic circulation carries blood between the heart and the rest of the body's tissues, and that's how it delivers the gas that has picked up in the lungs to the tissues, so the oxygen, to allow us to produce energy, and of course then also remove the carbon dioxide as a waste. The heart is a muscular double pump that's located in the thoracic cavity, and it is surrounded by a thin membranous sac that's called the pericardium. So it is a double pump because there are basically two sides to it, the right and the left side, and it basically pumps into two circuits, the pulmonary circuit and the systemic circuit. The heart wall has three layers. The epicardium is the outer layer of the heart. The myocardium is the thick middle layer of the heart, the muscular layer of the heart. And the endocardium is the innermost layer of the heart. That is a layer of the heart that is in contact with the blood that is rushing through it. So this diagram illustrates for you the systemic and the pulmonary circuit. So if you will, if you start at the heart here on the right side of the heart is going to receive unoxygenated blood from the systemic circulation. Is going to enter in the right side of the heart, and the right side of the heart is going to pump it to the pulmonary circuit, to the lungs. And at the lungs, that blood is going to pick up oxygen and is going to return by the pulmonary veins to the left side of the heart. And then the left side of the heart is going to receive it and then pump this oxygenated blood through the aorta to the systemic circulation for delivery of oxygen to the body, who's going to use it, and then you'll have deoxygenated blood and it's going to return back to the right side of the heart. So the four chambers of the heart are the left and right atria and the left and right ventricles. The tricuspid valve separates the right atrium and the right ventricle. The mitral valve separates the left atrium from the left ventricle. And then the pulmonary semilunar valve will separate the right ventricle from the pulmonary trunk. And the aortic semilunar valve separates the left ventricle from the aorta. Contraction of the right ventricle forces blood out through the pulmonary semilunar valve, through the pulmonary trunk, and then into the right and left pulmonary arteries to the lungs, where it picks up oxygen. And that blood returns to the heart via the left and right pulmonary veins. And this is where oxygenated blood enters the left atrium. And then contraction of the left atrium forces the blood through the mitral valve into the left ventricle, which then pumps it out to the aorta to be distributed to the rest of the body. Again, quick little illustration, the right side of the heart, the left side of the heart, so right atria into the right ventricle, and then it pumps out to the lungs, comes back from the lungs to the left atrium, left ventricle pumps it out the aorta to the rest of the body. And then again, so tricuspid valve is on the right side, mitral valve is on the left side, and then the semilunar valves are not represented here. Blood pressure. Each heartbeat or cardiac cycle induces a contraction and a relaxation of each chamber. Systole is contraction. And it develops pressure and it forces blood through the system, so through the aortas and arteries. And the diastole is the relaxation and it allows the chambers to fill again, so the atrial and then ventricle chambers to fill. So the two atria always contract together, they contract first, and then the two ventricles contract together and they contract next. And then there's usually a brief period of rest where nothing contracts, everything can start refilling. And so that would be one cardiac cycle. So blood pressure, which is measured by a sphygmomanometer or a blood pressure cuff, is a measure of the force of blood against these arterial walls. So it measures both ventricular systole and diastole. It's just systole is the highest number, diastole is the lowest number, because systole is a force as the heart is pumping, those ventricles are contracting and they're pumping the blood into the aorta in the arteries with full force. So that's the maximum force there. So that would be the top number, the highest number. And then diastole is basically the lowest pressure, is when everything is relaxed. It's the lowest pressure in the system. And so there's always some pressure in the system, especially, well, in the arterial system, for sure. And that's what we measure. We're measuring the pressure in the arterial system. The blood vessels, the arteries and veins have three layers that surround the lumen. The lumen is the opening, and the lumen is where the blood is flowing. Okay, so the tunica and ventitia is the outer layer. So it's what can anchor the arteries and veins all throughout your body. The tunica media is the middle layer. That's the layer that has the muscles that can allow the arteries to contract or dilate. The veins can also contract and dilate some. And then the tunica intima, or inner layer, is the endothelium layer that is actually in contact with the blood that's rushing through. The capillaries are thin and they only have the tunica intima, so they are only made of the endothelium, and that's it. It's very thin. And the arteries carry blood away from the heart, and arteries have a thick muscular wall that can expand when blood is pumped into them and then contract to maintain the flow and the pressure during diastole, which is when everything is relaxed. Arteries are located deeper than the veins, but it can be found by feeling for a pulse. And arteries branch into smaller arterioles, which then branch and form capillaries. Capillaries are a single layer of cells that basically it's just a tunica intima. And they are so thin that red cells have to go through single file through the capillaries. And they're where diffusion of gases and nutrients happen between the blood and the tissues. And in its chemical composition, capillary blood is more similar to the arterial blood than to venous blood, especially in warm tissue where blood flow is rapid. And then veins carry blood back towards the heart. The venules will leave the capillaries. So capillaries basically become venules, and then venules join together to form larger veins. And veins have thinner walls and less muscle than arteries, but they have a larger lumen. So they actually hold a lot more blood than arteries do. It's just the blood is low pressure and the walls are thinner. They have the same three layers. It's just their, again, their lumen is much larger and there's a lot less muscle, smooth muscle in that layer of the walls of the veins. Veins also have valves with them, and this is to prevent backflow of blood. So the in this picture, the blood is going to flow in this direction, right? Going that way. And so it would push through this opening, and then gravity can make it push back here, and that would cause the valve to close. That's how semilunar valves work. And there are position throughout the venous system to help return the blood back to the heart. And then, so let's talk a little bit about veins for phlebotomy. So there are three superficial veins that are on the anterior surface of the arm that are used for blood draws. So I have really fair skin, as you can tell. And so I actually took a picture of my arm. So that's my arm here, right side, right arm. And so you can see the three veins here. So this area here, that's you can see kind of the bluish color. This is where my median cubital vein is. Very easy to get to. This is the most used one. Another vein that's easy to use for phlebotomy is going to be the cephalic one. And so this one's usually on the outer or lateral side of the arm, right? And then the third one is going to be the basilic vein. It's going to be here. It's about right here for me. And so that one would be on the inner or medial part of the arm. And so here they are also represented in a graphic that kind of shows you where they're coming from. So here's your cephalic. You can see it's kind of on the outer part of the arm. And then here's the median cubital one. And then this one's the basilic one. Sorry about that. I didn't mean to click it real quick. There we go. This one is the basilic one. Okay. And so these are three easy sites to get to for blood draws. And then lastly, some major arteries and veins that you at least ought to know where they're at and what their names are. So the aortic arch coming off the heart, right, and kind of bending over. The posterior tibial behind the tibia, so that would be behind your knee. This is one where you could feel pulses there. Radial and ulnar are from your wrist. And so if you locate your thumb and go down, that's the radial one, and then the other one's ulnar. You can feel pulses at both of these locations. These can be the locations for arterial blood gas draws, especially the radial one. And you can even, the brachial one, sorry, I'm trying to orient the camera, is here, kind of close to where the basilic vein is. If you feel, you can, it's much deeper though, but you can feel for a pulse there also. Some major veins that you need to know the location of. So we have the carotid ones that would be draining the head, axillary veins, cephalic veins, and femoral veins. So there you go. That's quick little overview of the circulation, systemic circulation, pulmonary circulation, and veins that are of interest to us. So next, we're going to do a lymphatic system review.